In early June 1991, volcanologist Henry Glickin, his fellow researchers, and members of the media stood on the slopes of Mount Unzen. The volcano had been restless for weeks, spewing debris and threatening a full eruption. Authorities had already evacuated over 12,000 residents from nearby homes, but for Harry and his team, it was a rare opportunity to study the raw, unpredictable power of an active volcano up close. Then, without warning, a deafening blast rocked the slopes as an enormous pyroclastic flow tore down the hillside, straight toward them. In an instant, what began as a research mission had become a living nightmare. Located near the city of Shimabara in Nagasaki Prefecture, on Japan's western island of Kyushu, Mount Unzen isn't just a single volcano. It's a cluster of composite volcanoes. The most prominent are Mount Fujin, rising over 4,400 feet, and Heisei Shinzan, which towers at more than 4,800 feet, though the latter wouldn't even exist until after 1989, formed in the aftermath of a catastrophic eruption. But long before that, Mount Unzen had already earned a deadly reputation. In 1792, it unleashed a massive eruption that triggered the worst volcanic disaster in Japan's history. Mount Unzen is home to what are called lava domes, which are exactly what they sound like, mound-shaped protrusions that form as a result of viscous lava gradually being squeezed out of a volcano. Think of it like a molten cap sealing the pressure inside rather than letting it erupt freely. Sounds like a good thing, and it is, until one collapses. The collapse of one of those domes is what contributed to the 1792 disaster. A series of earthquakes triggered the collapse of the Mayuyama Dome on the volcano's eastern flank. The result was a catastrophic landslide that roared down the mountainside, obliterating the city of Shimabara in its path. When the debris slammed into the Ariake Sea, it unleashed a mega tsunami that devastated the coastline. More than 14,500 lives were lost. After that, Mount Unzen went quiet, and that silence would last nearly 200 years, until June of 1991. As early as 1968, signs began to emerge that Mount Unzen was stirring once again. A series of earthquakes shook the region through the early 70s, continuing until 1975. That year, the warning signs turned deadly. Bird and animal carcasses were discovered near Mount Fujin, victims of lethal volcanic gas being ejected from Mount Fujin. High concentrations of carbon dioxide were also detected, being emitted from rock fractures. The last time anything like this had happened was reported to have been during the eruption back in 1792. It would still take a little more time to build up another eruption, though the sporadic earthquakes that occurred from 1975 onwards certainly didn't help. Then, in November of 1989, another swarm of earthquakes began around 12 miles under and just over 6 miles west of Fujin. These earthquakes would continue throughout the year, and it just so happened that this coincided with Harry Glickin's arrival and subsequent volcanological research in the area. From 1989 onwards, Glickin worked on his postdoctoral dissertation while working as a research professor and a translator at Earthquake Research Institute of the University of Tokyo. Soon, he became involved with research that was looking closer at Mount Unzen, spurred on by the potential eruptive activity that had been occurring there in recent years. Almost a full year later, on November 17, 1990, a phreatic eruption took place. Also known as a steam blast eruption, this type of event occurs when magma superheats groundwater or surface water, causing it to flash into steam almost instantly. With the pressure building inside the volcano, jets of steam burst through the surface. At Mount Unzen, two vents near a mountaintop shrine suddenly erupted, blasting superheated water and volcanic ash high into the air. But it seemed by the tail end of 1990, however, that the volcano had slipped back into a calmer state. But this would only last a short while. In early 1991, Mount Unzen roared back to life, erupting multiple times as activity steadily escalated. By May 15th, heavy accumulations of volcanic ash near the summit triggered the first major debris flow, sending torrents of soil, rock, and volcanic fragments cascading down the mountainside toward the Mizunashi River at the mountain's base. More debris flows followed on May 19th, 20th, and 21st, leaving a series of large cracks on the west side of Mount Unzen, from which fresh lava began to emerge. Though Harry and his colleagues might not have realized, this was a sign that things were about to get much, much worse. The lava erupting from Mount Unzen was so thick and viscous that it began to form a dome near the summit. This continued to grow day by day, but eventually split and collapsed under its own weight on May 24th. But it didn't stop growing. Fresh lava from the crater below continued to rise, feeding the formation of new lobes that clung to the summit. Volcanologists like Harry Glickin weren't oblivious of what was happening. In fact, they tracked the process closely, even naming the first 13 lobes in the order they were formed. But as the lobes were pushed out by the newly supplied magma, they started to give way on the slopes of Mount Unzen. This meant the lava dome itself was due to collapse, risking a phenomenon known as pyroclastic flow, where debris and volcanic gases can flow down a mountainside. The first of these pyroclastic flows had occurred when the dome partially collapsed, and afterwards smaller flows were occurring more and more frequently. Within 2 days of the collapse, the flow was over 1.5 miles east of the lava dome, and by May 29th, it had managed to travel almost 2 miles. After being dormant for nearly 200 years, Mount Unzen looked ready to blow. The threat of a potentially disastrous eruption, especially given the severity of the one in 1792, was enough to urge the Japanese government to evacuate the vicinity. Following the initial debris flow in May, Shimabara City issued evacuation recommendations for several nearby towns within the Mizunashi River Basin, including Kita Kamikoba, Minami Kamikoba, Shirataki, Tenjin Motomachi, and Fudan Motomachi. By the end of May 1991, the authorities had urged around 12,000 local residents to leave their homes in case Mount Unzen fully erupted. On June 2nd, Harry Glickin would visit the mountain in person. Accompanying him were a group of scientists and journalists, two among them being Katya and Maurice Kraft. The Krafts were well known in the volcanologist community, considered by many to be pioneers when it came to the filming, photographing, and recording of volcanic activity, often coming within feet of lava flows. Throughout the 70s and 80s, the husband and wife duo were often the first to arrive at the scene of active volcanoes, documenting various eruptions. Usually, Maurice Kraft would film them while Katya Kraft took photographs. Their footage documented the immediate effects of volcanic eruptions on the surrounding areas, and this often played a considerable role in convincing local authorities to take volcanic threats seriously and cooperate with scientists. The Krafts might have been well known for being in situations like this one, but they certainly weren't the only people present on Mount Unzen looking to document what happened next. Makio Yanai, 31 years old at the time, was a cameraman working for the Japanese Broadcasting Corporation and was one of a number of journalists tasked with covering the eruption. Despite repeated warnings from local officials and firefighters about the dangers of staying in the area, particularly the risk of deadly pyroclastic flows, Makio and other members of the press remained. They weren't thrill seekers, they were just doing their jobs, chasing the kind of interesting news their viewers wanted, even if it put them at risk. Hoping to capture the pyroclastic flow on film, the news media chose a specific shooting spot that was on a road in the village of Kita Kamikoba. It provided the camera crews with a view of Mount Fujin directly in front of them. This spot was well within the evacuation advisory zone, situated 2.5 miles from the lava dome. It was also 2,300 feet from the Mizunashi River, the same river channel that had already seen multiple destructive debris flow. And at an elevation of 130 feet, many referred to it by the nickname of the Fixed Point. After the first pyroclastic flow on May 24th, more than a dozen crew members for different media outlets had lined up at the Fixed Point hoping to capture footage of the volcanic activity. These weren't researchers and experts like Glickin who were in this for the love of the game, though. Back in 1991, newspapers and other outlets in Japan had only recently started using color photographs in their papers, so many companies were competing for decent color photographs of the pyroclastic flow taking place at Mount Unzen. This competition only intensified when the Mainichi Shimbun, one of Japan's major newspapers, managed to snap some nighttime pictures of the pyroclastic flows on May 28th. This was a big deal. These would be some of the clearest images ever of pyroclastic flows, and that attracted a great deal of attention from all over the world. It drew in Harry Glickin and the Krafts, of course, but many other volcanologists and government officials entered the evacuation advisory area to take part in interviews and pose for photos. A number of visitors began gathering around Mount Unzen and near the Mizunashi River to observe the pyroclastic flows. Traffic in the area became pretty dicey as a result. Reporters had already been warned that they would likely be engulfed by clouds of volcanic ash. One of the official evacuation recommendations had even suggested that they leave the Fixed Point and find another area. If a large enough pyroclastic flow occurred, there was a strong possibility it would strike the Fixed Point. Many of the journalists in the area adhered to the warnings, abandoning the previous position and retreating to a point in the nearby town of Fukaya, just outside the evacuation zone. Makio Yanai and his bosses at the Japan Broadcasting Corporation stopped shooting within the evacuated area at the end of May, arranging for an unmanned camera to be sent into the Kamikoba area. But until this unmanned camera was ready, Makio was forced to head back into the Kamikoba area on June 1st. Since some of the broadcasters had managed to air footage of the bright red lava in the last few days of May, Makio's bosses were now demanding more footage. This meant that Kamikoba soon became the primary filming location for the press. It wasn't just media crews and volcanologists who were too close for comfort. Local residents were returning to their homes intermittently to recover some of their personal belongings, or would enter Kamikoba to complete housework or work on nearby farms. The area wasn't exactly a ghost town. Even after the evacuation advisory was issued, the Kamikoba District's fire brigade remained stationed nearby, alongside crews from Minami Kamikoba, some operated outside of the Kita Kamikoba Agricultural Training Center, which had initially been designated as an evacuation site for local residents. When the pyroclastic flows started to occur more frequently, those firefighters were also evacuated, relocating to the Shirotani Public Hall on the lower side of the Mizunashi River. But on June 2nd, they were instructed to return to the Kita Kamikoba Agricultural Training Center so they could ensure the safety of the civilians still in the area, including Harry Glicken and his fellow volcano experts. The surrounding area also had seen a temporary lull in rainfall, making it more likely that the fire crews would be needed to douse any flames caused by the flows. They'd also need to be on hand to guide any civilians out of the area if there came a need for an emergency evacuation. Evacuation orders for Tenjin Motomachi and Fudano Motomachi were also lifted, as well as the advisory for Shirotani. As evacuation advisories were being canceled, local fire brigades could no longer stay stationed in any towns located downstream from the Kamikoba area. That night, all 20 members of the Kamikoba Fire Brigade bedded down at the Agricultural Training Center, getting as much sleep as they could, but remained on high alert. The following day, on June 3rd, Harry Glicken and Katya and Maurice Kraft entered a danger zone located near the base of one of the Mount Unzen volcanoes. They believed that the worst had already passed. In their view, any potentially deadly pyroclastic flows had already swept through the area, allowing them to safely bypass any danger. At 3:30, a series of smaller to medium-sized pyroclastic flows began, until part of the lava dome that had been growing at the peak of Mount Unzen collapsed. Just as predicted, this triggered the first large-scale pyroclastic flow, which took place at 3:57 p.m. It was thought that the dome's collapse was possibly the result of depressurization taking place within the magma column, the result of a landslide deep inside the crater. The pyroclastic flow didn't reach the fixed point, but its impact was already being felt. A surge of volcanic gas and debris blanketed the slopes, and visibility around Mount Unzen quickly deteriorated. A dense cloud of ash began to spread through the area. To make matters worse, the weather had taken a turn. After a brief lull in rainfall, the skies had opened up. Since earlier that morning, it had been pouring, soaking the ground and thickening the ash. A few minutes later, another large pyroclastic flow would occur, with the surge descending toward the Mizunashi River Valley. The resultant spew of debris and volcanic gas would reach just over 2 miles out east of the lava dome, traveling down into the nearby valley. While most of the pyroclastic flow followed the familiar path of the Mizunashi River, something far more dangerous was happening. The pyroclastic surge had begun to spread outward in a fan shape. The flow from Mount Unzen wasn't just threatening to head towards the town where the firefighters were stationed and evacuees had taken refuge. The hottest part was also heading straight for the volcanologist's post. It began to flow downwards along the nearby Akumatsu-Dani River, but a sudden gust of wind from the south caused it to change directions. Seemingly thanks to an act of God, this change in direction was enough to allow local residents and the firefighters, as well as some of the news crews, to escape the intense eruption. Some of those sent to shoot the volcano ended up leaving their cameras behind, inadvertently capturing the eruption as it happened, but not everyone made it out. Over at the fixed point, media crews had carefully staged their getaway. Chartered taxis and company cars were lined up along the road, engines running, all facing south. They were ready for a quick escape after grabbing their exclusive up-close footage. But the conditions had changed, and not in their favor. The ash clouds from earlier flows combined with a relentless rain had reduced visibility to almost nothing. Not only did this ruin any chance of capturing their money shot, it meant that when the time came to flee, the drivers could barely see a few feet ahead. And to make matters worse, the pyroclastic surge that had flowed from the Akumatsu-Dani River had cut them off. A short distance from the fixed point, one of the firefighters stationed at the Kita Kamikoba Agricultural Training Center also made a critical error. He assumed that the deafening roar caused by the large pyroclastic flows was actually due to another debris flow. Stepping outside of the training center to check on the state of the Mizunashi River, he was engulfed by the pyroclastic surge. Those who were fleeing from the evacuation advisory area on their own began to suffer the direct effects of the scorching pyroclastic flow. Many sustained severe burns from the intense heat of the volcanic gas and contracted damage to their airways from breathing in the clouds of ash that swept over them. 16 crew members, including a number of students working part-time from the various media outlets, died as a result. Among the victims were 12 firefighters who had stayed behind, risking everything to safeguard evacuees. Two police officers also lost their lives trying to guide civilians to safety. Four taxi drivers who had been standing by with engines running to evacuate the news crews perished as well. Two city council workers tasked with the simple everyday duty of removing an election bulletin board were caught up in the surge and killed. And at the Kitakamikoba Agricultural Training Center, four local residents also lost their lives. One journalist, the photographer of the Yomiuri Shimbun newspaper, was killed while still holding his Nikon F4 camera, which managed to record a total of 7 frames of the pyroclastic flow. The images, though, were discolored and distorted by the intense heat. A professional video camera that had been used by Makio Yanai would also be recovered. Makio wasn't so lucky and died after being caught in the pyroclastic flow. His camera was melted by the high temperature, but despite being severely damaged, the tape it contained showed reporters watching the first pyroclastic flow from Mount Unzen, then relocating to the so-called fixed point to continue filming. Police vehicles arrived shortly after, issuing evacuation advisories, unaware that the second, much larger pyroclastic flow is already hurtling toward them. The footage ends with Makio asking what the rumbling noise was before he turns the camera toward Mount Unzen, and the footage cuts out. As for Harry Glicken and Katja and Maurice Kraft, the volcanologists were killed instantly when the massive pyroclastic flow surged over their observation post. Their fellow scientists, along with members of the press who had been watching them work, also lost their lives in the blast. In total, 390 local homes were burned to the ground as the eruption extended its deadly reach 2.5 miles from Mount Unzen's summit. Most of the casualties occurred near the so-called fixed point, and tragically, many died within the evacuation zone. Harry Glicken's remains were found on June 5th, 2 days after the eruption. Katja and Maurice Kraft were also nearby, found near their rental car, lying side by side, buried under a layer of pyroclastic ash. All three of the bodies were burned beyond recognition and needed to be identified using their personal items. Their positions seemed to indicate that Glicken made an attempt to flee from the oncoming pyroclastic flow, while the Krafts stayed where they were, perhaps to keep filming. However, any footage they were able to capture of the eruption was ultimately destroyed by the heat. Upon recovery, Glicken's body was cremated in accordance with his family's wishes, as were the Kraft's bodies. After news of his death, Maurice Kraft was posthumously quoted by the Associated Press as having said he wanted to die at the edge of a volcano pursuing his work. Volcanologists monitoring Mount Unzen had avoided raising the potential dangers of pyroclastic flows. They feared that it would cause panic amongst residents still working inside the evacuation zones. While Shimabara city officials and the media advised citizens to avoid entering the evacuation advisory zone, there was little clarification about the difference between debris flows and the far deadlier pyroclastic surges. Many locals mistook the threat for harmless dust clouds. Around 75% believed debris flows were more dangerous, while only 15% correctly identified the pyroclastic flows as the greater threat. In Kamikoba, the most at-risk area, just 5% fully understood the warnings, leaving the majority tragically unprepared for what was coming. Now go check out what happens to your body when you fall into a volcano, or click on this video instead.